privilege to work with all of you in my capacity as a graduate assistant, and now having this opportunity to speak to you to kind of kick off some of the content that we'll be covering today. So we're going to start by talking about shifting from technical to critical analyses of educational structures. So if you could, for a moment, just consider some school improvement initiatives that maybe you were aware of as your time in the classroom, right? So that's most of where my experience is grounded, is in my time in the classroom as a special education teacher, or initiatives that you may have been a part of in your role as district or state leaders. Just a second to consider them. All right, so, and you know, I can't know for sure what you thought of, but when I was looking at this content and I was considering what we'd be talking about today, some initiatives that came to my mind, right, had to do with maybe reducing suspension and expulsion. Maybe teacher retention and attraction, maybe an attracting teacher. And then also maybe one that might have come to your mind is narrowing the achievement gap. And this is the one that we're going to talk about today. Thanks so much. And we're not going to spend like a whole, I mean, we're not going to spend the day talking about achievement gaps. So this is an example that I want to bring to your attention, because it is so widely approached, right? No matter where you are or what district you're in, you probably can find in the history of most school spaces, right, some attempt at addressing achievement gaps. And there's a reason for this, right? This is, it's popular, right? It is it is in some way rooted in some types of research, right, or research. And it is also something that school districts and state departments can narrow or hone in on that pertains to a particular indicator. Right, and I just want to make a quick note too about the I don't necessarily want to say popularity of addressing achievement gaps, but Gloria Ladson-Billings, that's right, that if you do a Google search for achievement gaps, you get something like 11 million hits. Now, what's interesting about it is, even though, as I mentioned just a second ago, that when we're talking about achievement gaps, right, usually what we're talking about is a specific indicator that points to a gap in achievement. And I'm sure that you might be able to think of what that indicator might be. I will tell you, it's test scores, right? So one way to look at achievement gaps, or one way to consider achievement gaps, is that there's a specific indicator that, quote unquote, measures it, right? But what's interesting about that measure is that when you consider achievement gaps only, right, as measurable through test scores, you completely ignore that even the term achievement gaps just automatically implicates issues of race and class. Okay? So if you look at this graphic here, what we're looking at is achievement gaps in the middle. But then the other considerations that are so often implicated by the term, right, and by addressing this initiative, let's say, and narrowing them, but that are not necessarily measured or considered in effort to reduce them. So some of the things that we're looking at then are opportunity gaps, practices, right, of the school as well as individuals, power, disproportionality, privilege, and racism. So what we're going to do today, what we're going to start with, is shifting the focus, right, from specific indicators that might look very narrowly at particular initiatives in isolation or without context, right, and look at them in considering the other potential factors that might affect them. So what we see here, though, are some traditional approaches to school improvement. And if we continue to consider achievement gaps, what we might be looking at is fixing the numbers, right? So like I just mentioned a minute ago, is that when we're talking talking about school achievement or student achievement measured by a singular test score, right, or a singular indicator, and you hone your improvement efforts on shifting or moving that indicator, right? What you're talking about is shifting the number specifically. That's the aim, right? But also worth considering is that there's sort of a waterfall of effect, right, that happens when you focus on a specific indicator, a contextual of other things that might be informing it, right? What focusing on fixing the numbers might do is focus specifically on, it might re-emphasize instruction to the skills or to the basic skills that will move the indicator of test scores, right? It might increase the use of inappropriate assessment, particularly for English language learners, right? And it might also provide the sort of undercurrent, right, that I would say is rarely talked about in the open, but that provides this like kind of undercurrent of an incentive to move students who might not be scoring highly on these assessments out of the classroom, right, or out of the school even. And what I'm talking about is exclusion, and what I'm talking about is pushing students out who don't achieve well in these tests, right, or who don't score highly on particular isolated standards of measurement. Okay? Similarly, fixing the teachers focuses less on the actual implications of focusing on test scores and more looking at what might be happening with the teachers, where are the teachers failing. This is when you'll see efforts in turnaround schools, right? Where somebody might come in and replace an entire school staff, leadership, teachers as well. This also considers sort of piling on different types of professional learning, right? Without considering how these types of professional learning fit into a larger matrix, right, of systemic change. Okay. So I know we're talking about what it means to, I think Dr. Sherrick said, sit for, you know, 15 or 16 hours in professional learning, right? Or professional development day, or professional development 2 days, in contextual of a larger understanding of how these types of learning experiences fit more largely within an actual system change framework, right? And then lastly, and very importantly, what these approaches might do is look at fixing the student. So again, sticking with this idea of achievement gaps, if you're looking at moving the indicator, right, of test scores on a scale, and you're looking at the numbers, you're looking at what the teachers are doing, and you're looking at what the students are doing, what this might look like in practice is focusing specifically on remediating specific skills, right? I just said a minute ago, it might also look like actually moving the students out of their context, under the auspices of, you know, finding a better placement or somewhere that's more right for him, right? It might also look like disproportionate identification of students with disabilities, right? And even zero tolerance policies. Because when you're focused on a singular indicator, that's where the focus lies, right? And so what we're gonna do for the remaining of this session of this learning experience, right, is look at not only shifting the focus of the lens, but considering school improvement through 3 layers, traditional, contextual, and critical, in an attempt to surface the paradigmatic assumptions or truths, right, on which schooling functions, right, on which schooling relies, in an effort to, like I said, not only shift the lens, but even more broadly consider school improvement as something that is both culturally and individually